Greetings again today in the name of Jesus Christ, our wonderful Lord and Savior. Now we're glad to see you here in the auditorium of the Northside Baptist Church today. We welcome every one of you. We appreciate your presence. We're glad to have the visitors visiting with us today. And you that's listening out in the radio listening audience, we most certainly appreciate you tuning in to the Northside Baptist Church Hour that's coming to you live right from the auditorium of the Northside Baptist Church here in Athens, Georgia. Now, this is Preacher Edward speaking. We're hoping during the next hour we can be an inspiration to you. You out in the radio listening audience, if you'd call a friend, maybe a shut-in, and get them to tune in to the station where you're now listening, we'd probably be a blessing to them. We hope so, and I believe they would deeply appreciate it. And so if you do that, you'll help us in getting people to listen to this hour that's coming up. Appreciate your presence today. Appreciate you listening out in the radio listening audience. Have quite a few shut-ins, dear aged people that can't get out and go to church. Look forward to worship with us on Sunday morning by medium of radio. Keep these announcements in mind. Remember the service tonight. Our evening service begins at 6 o'clock. Now that'll give you plenty of time to get home before night. Some people, they're a little afraid to drive after dark for maybe various reasons. And so that will eliminate that. You won't have to worry about driving after dark, because if you hit 6 o'clock, then of course you can go home a long time before sundown. So remember, the service starts at 6. I hope you'll be here. Then Wednesday night, Bible study and prayer meeting as usual at 7:30. On Wednesday nights, we're making a study of the miracles in the Bible. We're having a wonderful fellowship around the Word on Wednesday nights. I hope you'll be here. Come and bring that Bible and get in on the spiritual blessings of the Lord. Now, I'm going to speak this morning on the Christian's peace like a river. If you have your Bible, turn to Isaiah chapter 48. I want to speak on the river of peace today. We have a lot of troubled hearts in the land, and we need to realize that God can give peace. We have a lot of crime being committed. Our young people killing themselves on the highways every day, every night. A lot of robberies, a lot of murders. But still, in spite of all of this, God's people can have peace. Now, while you're turning there, I want to say to the radio listening audience, we do have these tape available. We tape our Sunday morning broadcast, both the singing and the message. And they're available if you want to write in and send in a gift of $5 or more to help take care of radio expense. And request the tape. We'll send them to you. I'm still sending out the little widow's mite. You can write in and get the widow's mite at your request. I brought some back with me from the Holy Land. And I'll be glad to send you one as a souvenir. I am in need of hearing from the radio listening audience. My mail has been greatly off the past few weeks. And if you pray for me and write to me, I'll appreciate it very much. Most people take things for granted. They say, well, Preacher Edwards has been on there now in his 30, going into 36 years, and he'll be on tomorrow. Well, not too sure about that. We just go from week to week, and I hope that you'll pray for me and write to me. My mailing address is Virgil Edwards, P.O. Box 501, Athens, Georgia. 30603 is the zip code number. And that was 10 years ago last week. And those cold-blooded murderers are still in prison, being fed and looked after and cared for by the taxpayers' money. And those poor people, six of them out of the all-day family, were killed like animals. One man's wife was raped by all the men and then shot to death. And they haven't done anything about that yet. We have a corrupt, rotten, criminal judicial system in the state of Georgia that stinks to high heaven. Amen. In fact, it's that way all over this nation. One of those boys that committed most of the crimes, he said the all-day family should have been killed. They were Christian people, church-going people. He said he didn't like those kind of people. He said they ought to be killed. And he laughed about it, still laughing about it. Sitting over here near Jackson, Georgia, enjoying himself there, being fed and clothed and given medical care by the taxpayers. And they've been there and been on death row now for 10 long years. Now, if that's not a judicial system, it stinks to high heaven. Thou make a buzz and gurgitate. I don't know what it would take to do so. We got to do something about it. Beloved, we have politicians that'll say, well, if you'll elect me, I'll do something about the crime in Georgia or in America. And then when they get into office, they do nothing about it. I don't know what happens. I don't know whether they're bought over by the criminals or whether they get cold feet and afraid to do anything about it, or whether they just turn out to be straight out lies and won't do anything about it when they said they would. And we need something done about our rotten criminal judicial system in the state of Georgia and in this nation. It's pathetic. That was a jury that sentenced those men to death, and they should have been put to death even the very week after they were sentenced to die. And then our court system today, our judicial system, says, well, the jury, evidently they didn't know what they were doing, so we're just not going to bother about putting them to death. Why have a jury? And if the jury then says the person is to die, like the Bible teaches, and then our system does nothing about it, why have the jury? That's a mockery. That's pathetic. That's ridiculous. And whenever the law-abiding people in this state and in this nation rise up and make themselves heard about it, maybe we can get some politicians in office. They'll have intestinal fortitude enough to do something about it. If we don't, our American way of life is not going to be like this forever. That is, we're not going to have the same wonderful type we've had in days gone by, because the criminals are pretty well taken over in many phases of America through the dope traffic and various other ways. And sad, something has to be done, something must be done about the criminals in this nation. And I hope that you'll take that to heart. Isaiah chapter 48, and I begin reading with verse 12. Hearken unto me, O Jacob, and Israel, my called. I am he, I am the first, I am also the last. My hand also hath laid the foundation of the earth. My right hand has spanned the heavens. When I call unto them, they stand up together. Oh, you assemble yourselves and hear, which among them hath declared these things. The Lord hath loved him. He will do his pleasure on Babylon, and his arm shall be on the Chaldeans. I have spoken, yea, I have called him. I have brought him, and he shall make his way prosperous. Come ye near unto me, hear ye this. I have not spoken in secret from the beginning. From the time that it was there am I. And now the Lord God and his Spirit has sent me. Thus saith the Lord, thy Redeemer, the Holy One of Israel, I am the Lord thy God, which teacheth thee to profit, which leadeth thee by the way thou shouldest go. Oh, that thou hast hearkened to my commandments, then had thy peace been as a river, and thy righteousness as the waves of the sea. I want you to notice here the phrase where it says, peace been as a river. Now drop down to verse 22 to conserve time. The Bible said, there is no peace, saith the Lord, unto the wicked. That's why you have so much crime and people so disturbed and unsatisfied. There's no peace, saith my God, unto the wicked. Now in verse 18, peace been as a river. Now there's something fascinating about a beautiful river. In all nature, you find a few things more beautiful and interesting than a river. Now, the history of the human race has been written along the courses of its famous streams. For instance, there's the Nile, there's Euphrates, there's the Ganges, the Jordan, the Rhine, the Blue Danube. Just a few weeks ago, I stood by the Blue Danube beyond in Austria. And of course, in our nation, there's the great Hudson, the Ohio, the Missouri, and the Mississippi River, and many others that we find in this great nation. There's something about a river or a beautiful stream of water that's fascinating. And God speaks about these rivers symbolizing peace in the hearts and minds of his children. Now there are only two rivers in the world today, two major rivers, as far as we know, that run north. A few weeks ago, I stood yonder in Egypt by the River Nile. And the River Nile runs north. Down here in the state of Florida, the St. James River also runs north. And as far as I know, they're the only two major rivers in the world that run north. But there's something about that river that's a blessing. I'll mention some of these things as I move along in the message. Now, the Christian peace is like a river in its high and lofty source. In other words, a river has a beginning, usually up in a mountain or in a high place, and it begins to pick up and gain momentum as other little streams come into it, and finally it grows and enlarges to be a very wide and strong stream. A river cannot be produced without a lofty mountain to draw its nourishment. It must be fed by the clouds and for its reservoir, the vast treasures of heaven. Now, out of the mountains come that stream, and then from the clouds come the water. And there God begins the little stream of the river. And it comes out of the lofty heights. And in order for a Christian to have peace like a river, he must look upward. He must look to God. Only God can give that deep, settled peace. Now, the Mississippi had its beginning in the Rocky Mountains, and it grew to be a great river. Jesus, many times after his daily task, the apostles and disciples went into their homes, and Jesus went up on the mountain, the Mount of Olives, and other places, and there he spent the night on his face before God on the high mountain. While the disciples were troubled on the Sea of Galilee, Christ was on the mountain praying for them. And if you have the kind of peace that God wants you to have, and the kind of peace you should have, you must spend some time there before God on the lofty heights, as it were. That is in prayer and in meditation of God's word. Yonder in Greenville, many years ago, I spoke of this earlier about the city of Greenville. Some of the preachers in those days used to go up on Paris Mountain. And there they'd wait on God until God blessed them and filled them with the Spirit. There they would rejoice and they'd come down that mountain filled with the Spirit of God and preach with great power and great anointing. The Bible says, I will keep him in perfect peace whose mind is stayed on thee. Isaiah chapter 26 and verse 3. Secondly, the peace of a good man is like a river in the way it is sustained. Now we do know that the river must be sustained by rain and by snow. Yonder, a few weeks ago, when we made our last tour to the Holy Land, we were held up in Ammon, Jordan, because of the great snow on Mount Hermon. And the snow had begun to melt, and then overflowed the rivers, came into the Sea of Galilee, overflowed Jordan. And over Jordan was overflowing at that particular time. And we had to go around through Egypt and come back in through the desert because of the overflow of Jordan at that particular time. But it all had its beginning on Mount Hermon, one of the highest mountains in the Middle East. And that snow began to melt, and down that mountain came the water, down into the Sea of Galilee, down the Jordan River, down to the Dead Sea. But it had its beginning on the mountain from the snow and the rain. Our peace must come from above. It must come from God. If you have deep settled peace on your job, in your home, in your community, or wherever you labor, you must remember as a Christian that peace can only come from God. He'll give you a deep settled peace that the world cannot give, neither can the world take away. Now, if you're troubled in mind, if you're disturbed, if you're perplexed, if you get alone before God, become still before the Lord, and spend time before him, and wait on God, God will give you that still, settled peace that will come into your heart, and you'll have the peace of God in your heart, and of course, peace with God when you come to know the Lord. Number three, peace is like a river in its onward course. It cannot choose its channel. It must flow within its own. When that water begins to trickle down that mountainside, It begins to flow in its own. It can't choose its own channel and say, I'm going straight down. It must choose its own way as it moves down that mountainside. That channel is often rugged and winding. Many times that stream will turn to the left or turn to the right or go over other stones. And sometimes it's rugged and sometimes it's winding. Sometimes it may even kind of go under the vines, under the ground. You can't see it. And then it appears again. It cannot move all the obstacles out of its way, but it doesn't give up. I've known Christian people because they meet opposition. They run into a little criticism. They run into things that disturb them and they give up. But that little mountain stream doesn't do that. It finds a way to get around the obstacle. And as a Christian, if you're a born-again believer, you ought to be able to find a way to get around every obstacle in your path. God's grace is sufficient. There's no excuse to throw up your hands and give up and say, well, I don't like this, I don't like that, I'll just quit. That's exactly what the devil wants you to do. Now, the rougher the trail, the more beautiful the sound. I've been in mountains even up here in North Georgia. And the water began to trickle down that mountain and over the stones, the rough places. And the rougher the trail for that water, the more beautiful the sound. And then it'd come maybe to a fall and drop many feet. And you'd hear it as it hits the bottom. A beautiful, beautiful sound in the mountains of North Georgia and other places. Now those sounds become because of the roughness of the way. Or the dropping from one cliff to another. And so with the Christian, the rougher the way, the more beautiful you ought to be in your Christian life. That gives you an opportunity to exhibit your Christian experience and your Christian life as you sojourn for God. Some of the most sweetest people I've ever known, most spiritual people I've ever known, have been suffering Christians. They have sat and suffered over the years. Never saw a day without pain in their body. But you could tell they loved God by their countenance, by their testimony, by their very acts and deeds, with that loving Christ-like spirit, you knew they loved God. They'd been over the rough. It'd been rugged for them in years gone by, but that made them such a wonderful Christian. There's a great humble man that loved God, the name of John Vassar. He was called Uncle John Vassar. He was a bookseller and a Bible seller during the Civil War. He was taken prisoner by the Confederate at Gettysburg. They're doing the Civil War. When he was taken prisoner at Gettysburg, he went straight to the general, General Early. And he said to General Early, he said, General, do you love the Lord Jesus Christ? The general said to his orderly, he said, let that man go, or we'll have a prayer meeting all the way back to Richmond. Beloved, when you know God, when you serve God, you can make a mark wherever you go as a running river to the glory of God. Number four, peace is like a river in its gracious and benevolent influence. That river, as it flows, enriches the soil. As you travel by the rivers, you notice the valleys where they have beautiful corn and other vegetables, and there they grow wonderful crops beside that river. Why? That river enriches the soil. Not only that, it causes the trees to grow. As those roots penetrate out into the edge of that riverbank, those old trees stay fresh and grow tall and beautiful. Not only that, it gives water for animals and fowls. Occasionally you see a little animal come up and he drinks from that river. A fowl will fly by and get a drink out of that river. It moves the trash away and purifies at a certain distance. You could throw some trash in that river, it'll soon wash it aside and soon purify itself, because it's a river that keeps on moving. The very life of a river is found in its generosity. If it ceased to flow, it would become stagnant. And that's why you have so many stagnant church members today. They're not a blessing like they once were. They don't love God like they once did. They're not concerned about the church services like they were years ago. They have grown stagnant. They're not a blessing. You can't enjoy stagnant water. If you try to drink it, it's terrible. But good, fresh, sparkling water is wonderful. And we have many church members today. At one time, they flowed like a beautiful stream. They were a blessing. They helped the thirsty. They created thirst and helped the thirsty. But they began to slack up, neglected their Bible reading, their praying, their witnessing, their church attendance, their financial giving, and they became stagnant. And if you get around them today, they're griping, they're groaning about something. Everything goes wrong, and they just gripe and groan about it. They become stagnant. Oh, listen to me, dear soul. If you want to stay fresh and a blessing, then you must flow on like a beautiful river. We got too many stagnant church members today that other people don't even like to be around the fellowship with them anymore because they're groaning and griping and grumbling about something all the time. That should not be. That grieves the Spirit of God. We know as the river brings the snow from off of the mountains and the treasures of the lofty clouds, so must Christians bring blessings from above. If people are blessed by you, you must get your blessings from above. Pray them down from God. Ask God to make you a real inspiration. You must do that. It comes from above. Everything that you feed your soul on is from above as a Christian. And you must look to God to help you that you might be a blessing. Number five, the Christian's peace is like a river in its growth. When that little stream starts up in the mountains, it's a little trickle. You can put your hand over it and dam it up for a few moments. Or you could step across a little stream. Little lady, you could put a bridge across it and cross over it. But as that little stream continues on, there comes a time whenever you can't do that. You'll have to get a boat to cross it. I build a huge bridge to cross over it because the little river has grown wider and deeper as you moved on down the mountains and kept on moving. Beloved, as a Christian, you should grow spiritually and not let every little thing that falls in your path hinder you or stop you. You got too many weak Christians that they just, any little thing can come along and stop them, hold them up and hinder them. But if you determine you're going to be like a stream and have peace like a river, you can't let these things stop you. You can't let anybody, you can't let the devil hinder you. You must keep on keeping on. Many years ago, there's a man riding down the street in a wagon. Behind him was a big old bulldog, mean looking dog. He was following that wagon. He seemed as calm as could be, nothing disturbed him. Out from those homes ran the little fights, little rat terrors. All the little dogs came out biting and snapping, barking. They didn't get too close to the big dog, but they stood off and barked and barked and barked and growled. That old bulldog just kept right on down the street. It didn't faze him. He didn't act like he even heard them. They couldn't hinder him because sitting on that wagon was his master. And he had his eyes on his master. Nothing could deviate him from keeping his eyes on his master. He didn't turn and growl back at that little feist. He didn't snap back that little rat terror or that little beagle or whatnot. He kept his eyes on his master. He paid them no attention. And down the street he went. That's the way a Christian should be, like a stream. Don't let every little thing that comes along to dam you up or stop you or hinder you, don't let it do it. Determine you're going to be like that old bulldog. Keep your eyes on Jesus and move straight down the road and don't let anything hinder you. If the postman today listened and paid any attention to every little feist that barked at him, he'd never get the mail put up. And if you as a Christian, if you expect to mount anything for God, you can't listen to every little feist that barks and everything that comes along to hinder you or stop you. You must keep your eyes on God and keep moving on. So Christian peace is like that. Yonder in World War II, when I entered into the service, went to Fort Bragg, North Carolina, they just brought some old weather-beaten veterans back from Italy that made the landing at Salerno and that fought there in Italy. And they brought them back for America for some reason or another, maybe to train others. And we were lining up to go in for a chow. There some of those old weather-beaten men got at the end of the line. Some of the young upstarts getting ready to go into service said, "Hey, fellas," said, "Hey there," said, "come on up here, get ahead of the line. You fellas deserve to be in the front up here." They said, "Don't let it bother you, fella." Said, "We've been riding the tail in the line a long time. It doesn't bother us." They were just as calm and as settled as they could be. They weren't disturbed about a thing. They were old veterans. They had been through the war. They'd been in the battle. And it didn't disturb them because they were not in the front line. They'd soon be in the back. As in the front, it didn't matter with them. They'd go through the chow line as soon as they reached the food. But it didn't faze them. But some of the young boys, new recruits, were disturbed about it because they were not in the front. Beloved, a good seasoned Christian that loves God, he's not disturbed or pushed around or discouraged by the attitudes of some others. He moves right on for God. Just like the woman yonder on the way to New York in the ship. She had two daughters. She had one in New York and one in heaven. And she was going over to New York to see her daughter there. She left England. Her other daughter had died and gone on to heaven. A great storm came up and began to rock the old boat. People became very much afraid, all but this dear woman. She was sitting there with a smile on her face, as calm as could be. Someone said to her, said, "Mother, aren't you afraid?" Said, "No." "Aren't you disturbed? There's a storm on out here. This ship may go down." She said, "No, I'm not disturbed." They said, "Why?" She said, "Well, I had two daughters. One is in heaven, the other is in New York." Said, "I'm on the way to New York." Said, "If this ship gets to New York, I'll see the one there. If it goes down, I'll see the one in heaven. It doesn't matter to me which one I see." And she was just as calm as could be. You can't let every little storm and things that come along shake you or disturb you or discourage you. If so, you'll never mount anything for God. You need that peace like a river. Then number six, the Christian peace should be like a river in bringing happiness and joy. You know, children like to play around the river. People like to fish in it. People like to take boat rides in it. People swim in it. People have picnic areas around the river. Something about that river that causes people to be happy. You can hear little children singing and playing and jumping. You can see people swimming. You see people catching fish. You see people riding on their boats. You see people swimming. All of them happy. That river produces that joy. And so should every Christian be like that. You should have such an attitude, such a wonderful countenance, and the love of God in your heart until you make others happy around you and enjoy being in your presence. That's the way God wants us to be. Then finally, number seven, Christ's peace is like a river in an enclosing of its course on the earth. Now this river begins to move out of the mountain as a little stream. It enlarges as it moves on down the mountain, on down, on toward the sea. Did you know when a great river like the Mississippi, or the Columbia, or the Amazon nears the ocean, the great sea does not wait for that river to get there? Now listen to what I'm saying. The great sea doesn't wait for those rivers to get there, but comes with welcoming hands for many miles up the channel to meet it. That ocean moves up that channel. It goes up there to meet that river as the river comes in. God wants us to have peace like a river. And as we flow through life, as we come to the end of life's journey, God will meet us. There'll be people to welcome us when we get to heaven. Many people have left this earth saying, "Do you see? Do you hear what I hear? Do you hear that music? I see the angels. I see my loved ones." And when people get ready to leave this world, heaven opens up. Guardian angels come down to meet them and welcome them home. Like the great sea that moves up the channel to meet the rivers as they come in, they're welcome in. And so will it happen to you. The Bible said, "There's no peace, saith my God, for the wicked." You can have that peace today. You can have peace with God. You can have the peace of God. And the Bible says, as far as possible, you can have peace with your fellow man. The peace with God comes the moment that you're born again. The peace of God comes into your heart as you look to Him in faith and rest in Him and trust Him and let Him give you a settled mind, a deep, settled peace. And then you can have peace with your fellow man as far as possible, the Bible tells us. There may be some of you today, you're troubled. You spent a restless night. You're worried about something. You're disturbed. Things are not going right. God wants you to settle down and calm down and let that deep, settled peace only God can give come into your heart. I have a preacher friend over in Greenville, South Carolina. He's retired now. He's a man, along with my mother, won me to God. Brother Alvin back here knows him. Brother W.F. Lister used to be pastor of the Westview Baptist Church. Brother Lister left Westview and went to North Carolina, then came back to Siloam Baptist Church, and he was so disturbed out there at Siloam. He didn't have peace. He knew something had to happen. He got his Bible. He went off in the woods. He got on his knees with the word of God and before God, and he stayed on his knees until a deep, settled peace came down into his heart. When that man came back to the parsonage and back to the church, he's a different man. He had the peace he needed to get the job done. God can give you the peace that you need to do the job, to get through life, to serve Him, to love Him, to take care of every need that you have, and God wants to give you that peace. Thank you. You've listened well. Stand to your feet. Dear Heavenly Father, I pray today that You'll use the message. Lord, no doubt there's someone out in the radio audience troubled and need this peace like a river. No doubt, Father, there's someone here in this auditorium that's been troubled and battling with thoughts and meeting maybe discouragement and opposition. They need this peace only You can give. God, grant that peace today. Maybe somebody needs to get saved and get peace with Thee. Then the peace of God. Lord, have Your way in this invitation. I pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Debbie's going to play a couple of stanzas as she plays on the instrument. If you're here, you need to get saved, come back to God, join the church for any reason. God prompts you to move forward. I want you to obey the Lord while she plays, while we wait. We want to help you. We will help you in your coming. Is God speaking to your heart today? Do you need to come forward?